point of pride. Professor Mooney is a native of Umatilla County in eastern Oregon, which is a rare distinction in these halls. So welcome, Professor Mooney. We look forward to hearing from you. And then finally, and very excitingly, we'll hear from Chet Orloff, who is a member of our board of directors, and he will unveil the exhibit that I mentioned, the exhibit on the diaries of Matthew Deady, that will be available on our website as well as in printed format below. So, with no further ado, Chief Justice Balmer.
Thanks, Ryan, for the kind introduction. Jim, I'm glad you made it up here. I'm covering things up until 1859, and then there was going to be a long blank period in Deady's life. So, it really is a privilege to be here at this historic courthouse to talk about Judge Deady, the man to whom we're indebted for having it constructed, who served in it for so many years. I think all of us who argued cases here as lawyers have a special place in our hearts for this courtroom. It is perfectly proportioned. It is dignified yet intimate, and I at least felt a flutter of excitement when I appeared here. I talked to another lawyer today, and they said, "Don't you always get a little scared when you come in here?" I said, "Yes, but at least this time I'm not going to have three judges up here asking me questions." But we might have time for questions later. So it's also an honor to be here with Professor Mooney. Jim is the foremost authority on Matthew Deady, and I'm certain he has forgotten more about Judge Deady than any of the rest of us are ever likely to know. And one of the reasons I'm going first is so that Jim can correct any really egregious errors I make. And in the interest of full disclosure, I should say that I have done some original research on Deady. I've been interested in him and in early Oregon legal history for a long time, but I am relying throughout on Jim and David Johnson and others who have toiled in these vineyards, as well as my law clerk Zoe Turrell, who provided a lot of good assistance, our state law librarian Catherine Bowie, and my friend Keith Garza. Now, I have a very limited PowerPoint show, and Jim, I understand, has an elaborate one with all sorts of interesting slides. Mine are less. Now, one of my excuses for this is photography was just developing. So when we think about Deady's early life, there are not very many photographs, and this was the earliest photograph I could find of Deady and his family, and this is from 1864 when he's already a federal judge. So this is Deady and his family. He did have one more son later, and this is Deady as whoever wrote the caption here, it may have been Malcolm Clark, the judge in a less austere moment about 1870-72. But let's stick with this Deady for the time being, because we're talking about the earlier part of Deady's life. So when we look back at his life, we usually focus on his really illustrious career as Oregon's first federal district court judge and his quite amazing diaries from the 1870s and 1880s. But my more modest task over the next few minutes is to talk about Deady's work before he became a judge on the U.S. District Court for the District of Oregon and about his lasting influence on the Oregon state courts. So I'll say just a few words about his early life. Judge O'Scanlan mentioned a few of the highlights, and I'll mention a few more. And then I'll give some attention to three aspects, don't worry, it'll be 2 minutes on each of three things, of his pre-1859 career. His work on the Oregon Territorial Supreme Court from 1853 to 1859. His important role as the president, Judge O'Scanlan mentioned, of the Oregon Constitutional Convention in 1857. And his ongoing work, which has not been mentioned, in the development and codification of Oregon statutes, both before and after he became a federal judge. Jim, I think, will talk a little bit more about Deady's life, so let me just give the briefest sketch to provide some background. Malcolm Clark, who edited the Deady Diaries, begins his introduction to Deady this way: "He was not of distinguished birth and regretted it." And this tells you a lot about Deady. Throughout much of his life, he had a complicated relationship with wealth and status and social class. In 1821, his father Daniel had emigrated from Ireland to Baltimore, where Irish Catholics were welcomed as they were not in many other American cities at the time. And Matthew Paul Deady was born there in 1824. Daniel was an itinerant school teacher, and the family was poor. They moved often, Maryland, what's now West Virginia, Mississippi, Missouri, Kentucky, Ohio. Matthew's mother died in 1834. He was 10. He spent time with the maternal grandfather and then returned to his father in Ohio a few years later. As a teenager, Deady had a contentious relationship with his father, and he left home for good at the age of 17. He apprenticed himself to a blacksmith, but also obtained a teaching certificate and started reading law. By the age of 22, he was reading law at an office in St. Clairsville, Ohio. The next year, 1847, he was admitted to the Ohio Bar, but like many other young men at the time, economic necessity and opportunity took him out west, and he ended up in 1849 teaching school in Lafayette, Oregon. The following year, he was admitted to the Oregon Bar, and he quickly involved himself in politics. Was elected to the Territorial Assembly, and Oregon had, of course, become a federal territory, United States territory, in 1848. Deady was smart and ambitious and a lifelong self-promoter. Exhibit A in the self-promotion business is the Deady Reports,
which I found in our library last week.
Now, this is as if Judge Graber said, I'd like to burnish my reputation a little bit. Why don't I have a law publishing company publish the Graber Reports, and we'll sell these. So Deady collated and published and sold his own opinions. That's just an example of his self-promotion. He actually sent copies of his opinions to better-known judges, including Supreme Court justices, hoping he'd get cited. I could name some more recent judges who've done that, but I won't. And he sent them to the law reviews. And when he gave speeches, he gave a lot of orations, 4th of July, and all sorts of occasions. And he would send the speeches to the newspapers, and sometimes he'd have them published to sort of help his career along. The good thing about it, though, when you read his diaries, is you realize he sort of knew what he was. He was not blind to the fact that he was sort of ambitious, and he felt a little, maybe that was not as virtuous as it should have been, and there are some things that maybe he did that he shouldn't have been. But he was a lifelong self-promoter. So Deady became, let's go to this version of Deady. He became associated with a group of Democrats known as the Salem Clique, including Asa Hill Bush, the publisher of the editor of the Oregon Statesman, and General Joseph Lane, and both of them worked to advance Deady's legislative and his judicial career. At Lane's suggestion, President Pierce appointed him to the Territorial Supreme Court, as Judge O'Scanlan said, in 1853, and he served until statehood. What Judge O'Scanlan did not mention is that in 1858, he ran for and was elected to what was to become the Supreme Court of the state of Oregon. We still feel slighted by this. Sensing a federal judgeship, he declined the office. And in fact, he was appointed to the federal bench by President Buchanan in 1859. Before turning to the three topics I was going to talk about in terms of his career with Oregon as a state, I should note a less attractive aspect of Deady's politics at this time, namely his outspoken support for slavery. In Deady's view, slavery was permitted under the Constitution and by law in the southern states, and because it was lawful, that was the end of the discussion. He saw, at least at that time in his life, no difference between holding another person as property and holding land or livestock as property. He had lived in the South, and he did not see slavery as a moral evil. Indeed, he ran for his seat at the Constitutional Convention and for his seat on the Oregon Supreme Court as a pro-slavery candidate. Yet times changed, and with the Civil War, his loyalty to the Union, a constitutional entity that could not be sundered by the unlawful means of secession, that trumped his support of slavery. So it was the rule of law again. He said, you can't break the Union apart. And as Malcolm Clark notes, by 1862, he was a strong Union man. And for the remainder of his life, he was a Republican, although not a very ardent one. And at least as to other minorities, although perhaps not African Americans, his views changed over the succeeding decades, as Jim may talk about. So surveying Deady's legacy first as a member of the Territorial Supreme Court, there's not a great deal to say. Deady and the other judges he served with on the three-person court during the mid-50s, 1850s, George Williams as Chief Justice, and first Cyrus Olney, and then Reuben Boyce as the other associate justices, were thoughtful and competent, far better judges than the early appointees to that court. Under Williams, the court was well-organized and respected. The three judges served individually as trial judges, and Deady served primarily in a Southern Oregon district, and then they sat together as the appellate court. Deady was considered thoughtful and judicious by those who appeared before him as a trial judge, but he had little opportunity to show off his knowledge as a writer of judicial opinions. Of the 66 opinions issued by the Territorial Supreme Court, while Williams was the Chief Justice, Williams himself wrote 43. So this is Williams, and we could spend a whole another day talking about Williams, who, as many of you know, was Grant's Attorney General. He was appointed by Grant to be Chief Justice of the United States, but was never confirmed. That was an East Coast biased against West Coast folk. Well, there's some other issues too, corruption and... But that one aspect of it was the sort of elites of the East Coast didn't want this guy from Oregon. But in 1902, at the age of 79, Williams was elected mayor of Portland after a long and successful career practicing law here and served for 8 or 10 years or something as mayor. So Williams is a fascinating guy, too. But Williams wrote most of the opinions himself, and Deady wrote very few. His name is virtually absent from the surveys of the important decisions of the Territorial Supreme Court. This is volume one, can't see it very well, of the Oregon Reports. And this is the first volume. It has Oregon Supreme Court opinions, but it also has all the Territorial Supreme Court opinions, all 66 of them. And just for good measure, it adds at the end about 80 or 90 pages of opinions written by Judge Deady while he was on the Federal District Court. Not Oregon State Court opinions at all. This is Deady's first appearance in the Oregon Reports. It consists of a single sentence appended to Judge Williams' opinion in Parrish v. Stevens, 1853. You can see it at the bottom of the left page. It says, page 5, Deady Justice dissenting. That's it. That was his opinion. Deady dissented, but he wrote no opinion. Gave no explanation of his vote. But what's interesting about the case, and Jim has written extensively about these cases, it was one of several cases that were litigated over decades involving a dispute over whether the early proprietors of Portland had in fact donated for general public use a large riverfront levee area and a downtown schoolhouse site. And I'm quoting from Jim without attribution, but I picked up a lot of this from him. One of his articles. Although somewhat narrow, formalistic, real property law arguments could be made in support of the proprietors, and we're talking here about the Portland founders, Pettigrove and Lovejoy, and people that bought directly from them or inherited Lounsdale and Stark were involved in these things in the later years. Justice Olney was the trial judge, and he concluded that the plat maps the proprietors had prepared clearly designated the areas as reserved to the public. The proprietors had repeatedly told the city and other settlers that they had so designated the property, and it had been treated as public property by all concerned. Only said that the proprietors and others associated with them had become afflicted with, quote, an itching palm for this attractive property, and were trying to renege on their earlier promise. On a later request from Olney's decision for a rehearing, after Olney ruled against them, Williams agreed with Olney, but Deady, as noted, dissented without opinion. 8 years later, the same issue came before Deady, now a federal district court judge, and here he ruled in favor of the proprietors, rejecting the primarily equitable and public purpose arguments offered by the city in favor of the strict view of private property rights asserted by the proprietors. Similarly, formalistic approach is evident in some other opinions Deady authored. Time prevents me from getting into all of those interesting cases. But there's an election law case that sort of shows his formalism. Deady held that the votes from one precinct should not be counted because the statute required that the poll book be sent by the election judges for the precinct to the county auditor with their certificate as to the vote in that county written in the book. The judges of the election in this particular county, however, had simply written out their certificate and returned it, but had not written the certificate in the poll book. Deady said the votes could not be counted, and that changed the results of the election for one of the candidates. When the case came before the full court, it was overturned. Chief Justice Williams, let's go back and enjoy looking at Williams for a minute. Chief Justice Williams wrote the opinion, saying quite sensibly, quote, true, the clerks should have written out their certificate in the poll book, but this error is not fatal to the return, for in point of fact, it makes no difference whether the certificate is written on one piece of paper or another, provided it is written and contains what the law requires. Deady filed a thoughtful and vigorous dissent, extolling the importance of the strict application of election and probably indeed of all laws. Quote, if in this particular instance, this instruction of the law would operate to exclude votes that were actually given in good faith, it is a misfortune, which the parties must submit to for the time being. Mistakes are of daily occurrence in human affairs, and if the law were to be lengthened or shortened to meet each particular case, it would beget more confusion than it would correct. So Deady wrote several other opinions as a trial judge and on appeal that I'm not going to go into, but they're really quite good. They're not interesting. They're good. Although not quite Holmesian in brevity or originality, his opinions are generally written in a clear, direct, occasionally even elegant prose style, and they demonstrate a ready grasp of common law principles and statutory analysis. However, to my mind at least, Deady, during this period, seemed to default sometimes to legal formalism, giving shorter shrift to equitable arguments or pragmatic outcomes than his colleagues on the territorial court. So Deady's second role in Oregon legal history was as the president of the State Constitutional Convention in 1857. A solid majority of the 60 convention delegates were Democrats, and prior to the official convening of the convention, the Democrats caucused and agreed that Deady would be elected to preside, and he was. Deady was a 33-year-old lawyer and politician eager to make a name for himself, and rather than follow George Washington's example in Philadelphia and remain above the fray, he frequently took the floor to debate key points and offer his own amendments. One of the issues he actively debated was constitutional restrictions on corporations. As David Johnson of Portland State has written, Deady, at the time of the convention, was more of an 18th century agrarian Jeffersonian Democrat, and he idealized rural life and small farmers, distrusting corporations. He proposed making corporate shareholders liable for all the debts of corporations, saying that he was not favorable to the growth of corporations. Others, including Williams, all these folks were at the convention, argued that such potential liability would discourage investment and be fatal to the prosperity of the state, and the proposal was defeated. Deady was successful in arguing for a strict ban on the payment of any state money for religious services, one aspect of the strict separation of church and state that the Oregon framers adopted, and he and George Williams fought off efforts by anti-judge delegates to give juries responsibility for deciding the law as well as the facts in a case. Deady's racial views were also on display at the convention. A draft provision on voting rights restricted suffrage to white males, and another stated, quote, no Negro, Chinaman, or mulatto shall have the right to vote. When these limitations were discussed, Deady proposed that the latter provision require that no person other than those of the white race shall have the right of suffrage. Another delegate objected, pointing out that under that standard, quarter-blood Negroes, that's in quotes, might claim the right to vote because they had a predominance of white blood. Deady responded by moving to amend the provision to include the word pure before white. William Bristow went Deady one better, suggesting an amendment to add the word Simon before pure to general laughter, according to contemporary newspaper accounts. Now, Johnson observes that the convention could treat the issue lightly because they could not conceive of non-white suffrage ever coming to pass. But the debate did have a practical significance because a number of Oregon settlers before statehood had married Native American women, and they certainly wanted their offspring, well, at least their male offspring, to be able to vote. As finally passed, the Constitution gave the right to vote to white male citizens over 21. The restriction on voting rights, in fact, remained in the Constitution, at least in the constitutional text, until 2002, although its legal effect, of course, was ended with the adoption of the 15th Amendment in 1870. The entire convention lasted barely 5 weeks. Despite Deady's strong views and his support of the losing side on a number of votes. He was widely considered to have presided fairly and impartially, and he earned the respect of most of the convention. One delegate, John McBride, later remembered Deady at that age as, quote, a man large in stature, of impressive manner and bearing, smooth in speech, courteous and affable in intercourse, though he had a dignity and firmness as a presiding officer. We don't have time to get into Deady's more general political views, but both Jim and David Johnson in various writings discussed Deady's later move away from this Jeffersonian agrarianism I talked about and that was on display in the convention to development of somewhat unique eclectic views based on his understanding of the Federalists like John Adams and Alexander Hamilton. As to Deady at the convention, I'll leave the last word to McBride, who said of Deady, quote, he was a great admirer of rusticity. Although his tendencies toward an aristocratic life were strong, he was an admirer of simplicity in home life. I think he divided mankind into two classes, those made to rule and those to be ruled. He was a student of medieval history and never missed an opportunity to eulogize the times when baronial chiefs and feudal castles ruled their followers and gloried in knightly deeds and paternal protection. I might make one other comment about John McBride, who has, at the end of Kerry's compilation of the Oregon Constitution debates, which all of you Oregon lawyers, at least, or those in the state courts need to be familiar with. But McBride has a wonderful reminiscence of Deady, and he points out that Deady supported him in an election for Congress one time because Deady felt that the Methodists had too much power over the Oregon congressional delegation, and McBride, Deady said, having no religion at all, would be able to help break the Methodist lock on power. That leads me to one other brief digression about Deady, which allows me to quote Malcolm Clark again, which I love to do. This is from Malcolm Clark's introduction in his little history of Deedy's life at the beginning of the edited letters. Deady had left the Catholic Church as a teenager, but as a leading citizen of Oregon, of Portland, at least, it was unthinkable that he would be unchurched in those days. As with much else, he wrote, Clark's description, much else that Clark wrote, his description is priceless. He says this, the judge was not notably religious, and Lucy, his wife, oops, there's Lucy, had been raised a Presbyterian of the Cumberland persuasion. They selected Trinity Episcopal, less perhaps for the nature of its teaching than for the quality of its congregation. Once he had become a member, the judge attended with metronomic regularity, and he pursued Trinity business with such vigor that the clergy must frequently have wished their most distinguished parishioner had gone elsewhere. The final major contribution that Deady made to the development of Oregon state law, and in some ways the most enduring, was in the decidedly less glamorous role of compiler and codifier of statutes. He has been called the Oregon Justinian, after the Roman emperor who organized and codified centuries of Roman law and legal precedent. Think for a moment about the way legislatures adopt laws. I admit, I've been a lawyer and judge for 35 years. I had not really given codification much thought. But think about it. The legislature passes one bill, say in Deady's time, authorizing a ferry over the Willamette. Another on the jurisdiction of circuit courts. Another increasing the penalty for horse theft. And as these are approved by the executive, they become published in the law books that are sometimes called session laws or general laws, one by one. But if one wanted to look at all the criminal laws, or the laws governing court procedures, you'd have to consult the session or general laws of each legislative session. It is the compiler or the code maker who pulls all these laws together, the laws on a particular subject that are passed over the years, into one place and organizes them into a coherent structure. Now that work is done by legislative counsel, Mr. Chamoff, good to see you, former legislative counsel, working for the legislature, same thing in Congress. But it was Matthew Deady and another important figure, James Kelly, who made the first Oregon territorial and then state laws accessible to judges and the public by doing the tedious but essential work of putting individual laws into a usable compilation under different subject headings. In 1850, the legislature, oops, I'm going to go back a little bit, because I know this is very important. In 1850, the Legislative Assembly directed the Territorial Secretary, Edward Hamilton, to organize the laws that the 1850 session was going to pass and previous sessions for publication. Hamilton, in turn, asked Deady, in his mid-20s and a new member of the Assembly, to compile and edit the enacted laws into a usable volume. So Deady arranged the laws into this book. He put them in alphabetical order. It's called General Laws of Oregon, I think. And this was published in 1851. And what he did was to take all the laws that existed, all the territorial laws, and put them into categories. And so they go from arbitrations, that's the first entry, and then next is attachments, then bridges, then cattle, and it goes all the way through wills. Also, new innovation, he had a table of contents and an index. That volume has been referred to as the first code published in Oregon, and while scholars debate whether that really was a code, it was an attempt to organize all of Oregon's statutes and make them available in a single volume. Now, Deady's version did not bear his name, and it was soon supplanted by another more comprehensive codification of territorial laws prepared by James Kelly and two other code commissioners designated by the territorial legislature. But Deady returned to his work on Oregon statutes in 1860. Remember, now he's a federal judge. The state constitution provided that all laws in the Oregon Territory should continue in force after statehood, and the first legislature appointed code commissioners in 1860 to make the necessary adjustments, incorporate the territorial laws that had been passed after the 1855 Kelly Code, and also any new state statutes were passed. Three commissioners were appointed, not including Deady, but one bowed out, and Deady took his place. Deady worked first during 1861 and 62, I think it's this volume here, on preparing a code of civil procedure, relying but not always giving much credit to the earlier Kelly Code, and the legislature adopted his code of civil procedure, this is it, in 1862, along with the Corporation Act that Deady had drafted. His renown as a drafter of statutes was such that procedural and substantive laws he drafted often were enacted by the legislature with little or no change. Of course, that was the point of having code commissioners, at least in part. Deady and the other commissioners went on to complete the important codification of all the general laws of the territory and state of Oregon, although the resulting volume, this one, bears only Deedy's name. In his immodest introduction, Deady writes, "No labor has been spared to make it what the Assembly intended, a complete compilation of all the general laws of Oregon arranged in the order and method of a code. The reader may never fully appreciate the trouble and difficulty involved in the compilation in a codified form of the scattered and oft-amended statutes of the state and territory covering a period of 10 years of almost annual legislation. The change in the nomenclature of offices and officers and the new distribution of their powers and duties caused by the transition from a territorial to a state government made the labor of compiling the statutes of the former period almost the equivalent of redrafting them." So this volume, The General Laws of Oregon, 1845 to 1864, compiled and edited by M.P. Deady, is what we call the Deady Code. It was published in 1866. It was a singular achievement, and we are indebted to Judge Deady for doing what was plainly time-consuming and often tedious work. Many of our current statutes derive from these early laws, and some of our statutes still contain exactly the language that Deady drafted. When we interpret statutes in the state courts, we frequently rely on the Deady Code as the authoritative source of early Oregon law. As George Williams later said, "No hand has been so strongly impressed on the legislative and judicial history of Oregon as that of Judge Deady." So, closing down now, what of the impact of Deady on the state courts of Oregon? Is Deady still relevant? Has his work had a lasting influence? The answer is an emphatic yes. As president of the Constitutional Convention, Deady had a major hand in shaping the organic law that we still follow today. And although it's been amended hundreds of times, Oregonians have never seen fit to replace or substantially revise the Oregon Constitution. And it is one of the more durable, or maybe I should just say, one of the older state constitutions still in effect. Another aspect of Deady's legacy is the Oregon court's reliance on his opinions as precedent. Through the magic of Westlaw and Nexus Lexus, I can tell you that the 9 majority and 3 dissenting opinions Deady wrote while on the territorial Supreme Court were not cited very often. 7 times in the 1800s, 18 times in the 1900s, and once in the current century. An opinion I wrote in 2002 discussing the standard for when a court may withdraw a claim from a jury's consideration. As a federal district judge, however, Deady published over 500 opinions, and the Oregon courts have cited those more than 135 times. In recent years, our courts have grappled with one particularly important provision of the Constitution that provides for open courts and also a remedy for injuries, a provision that actually has its roots in the Magna Carta. We have often cited a Deady opinion that interprets the provision, Eastman v. County of Clackamas, 1887. In fact, we've discussed that opinion in 4 significant cases since 2000. And in 50 decisions where we've cited the debates at the Constitutional Convention to help interpret some constitutional provision, the Oregon Supreme Court and Court of Appeals have mentioned Deady's comments specifically 50 times, 16 times in the current century. But Deady's ongoing relevance is perhaps most apparent in our continuing reliance on his lower profile work as a codifier and compiler of statutes. The Oregon Supreme Court regularly uses the Deady Code to assist in interpreting and understanding current statutes. We've cited it over 600 times, including 50 times since 2000 and 5 times just this year. And the Court of Appeals has cited it 50 times since 2000 and 3 times this year. So Deady's career on the Oregon Territorial Supreme Court was not an auspicious one, and he never assumed the seat to which he was elected on the Supreme Court of the State of Oregon. Yet because of his work on the Oregon Constitution at the convention, because of his federal court decisions, and most significantly, his eponymous code of 1866, Deady's name has appeared regularly in the opinions of the Oregon courts for more than 150 years, and it will for many years to come. He would have liked that. Thank you.
So some smart person tell me what I do with this thing. Is this?
You keep going to the end and get to this. I've been using this one.
This one.
Oops. Now we're going to be smart. Yeah. All right. Not here.
I'm here too.
Can't see it. Can you give us a hand here?
Yes.
Good. We'll get the technical person up here.
I should add that Professor Mooney was coming up here and got stuck in traffic south of a large wreck down on I-5, and we were worried.
2 hours.
2 hours, yeah. So I had to take a quick look at his slides just in case I had to step in and pitch for him.
That would have been interesting.
It would have been very interesting, but we're glad you're here.
Yeah, thank you. So, all
there
right.
You go.
So this one, nope. There. We're good. So good afternoon. May I begin by saying I'm delighted to be here with you today and honored to share speaking duties with our uncommonly learned Chief Justice. As Chet said, there was this terrible accident on I-5 just south of Albany, and we were all held up for 2 hours, which was almost worth it for me at least, to see my wife in the men's room of the Hilton helping me change out of my running clothes into this, putting stuff in the suitcase. It's been quite a day. So my job is to pick up more or less where Tom left off and talk to you for perhaps 20 minutes, just a tiny bit about this man's 34 years as Oregon's one and only federal district judge. I could, of course, talk a lot more about Judge Deady, but I can see that many of you are getting thirsty and want to get on with this. Okay. This is where it all began. I love this language. first entry in the district court notebooks. Be it remembered that it determined the United States District Court for the District of Oregon begun and holden at Salem on the 12th day of September, Anno Domini, 1859, the following proceedings were had, to wit. The Honorable M.P. Deady, having been appointed judge of this court, having taken the oath required by law, took his seat upon the bench, and his commission with the oath of office endorsed thereon was ordered to be entered at length in the minutes. Thus began the United States District Court for the District of Oregon, presided over by 35-year-old Matthew Paul Deady. And what a career, indeed what a life, he would have until he died in 1893 at the age of 69. Deady revered the law, especially the common law, as foundation and guardian of a rational, orderly world. A devoted Anglophile, he read widely in English history and literature, and for him, Westminster Hall was the supreme bulwark of liberty and buttress of order. In a lecture entitled Law and Lawyers, he delivered from time to time to various groups, Deady explained how the common law pervaded virtually all American law and served as source and panoply of the nation's cherished tradition of ordered liberty. This is Deady. The common law people, the English race, wherever they go, establish limited governments with parliaments and juries. The common law is the source and panoply of all those features of our system that distinguish us from the subjects of absolute governments, ancient or modern, either by monarchs or majorities. It was made by freemen for freemen. As an aside, I'll tell you, Deady's quite pointed references here and elsewhere to order, ordered liberty, and absolute government by majorities, as well as by monarchs, echo his quite numerous diary entries expressing disappointment, occasionally even disgust, with the political and journalistic demagoguery of his day. I'm actually quite confident he would hate Fox News, though he might not care much for Jon Stewart either. So again, the point is, Judge Deady saw law and lawyers, notably the federal courts, as an indispensable counterweight to the occasional dangers of American politics run amok. Law as the bulwark of liberty and buttress of order. All right. I do want to tell you about one small handful of Deady's actual decisions, ones that I believe help illustrate an important central theme of his genuinely distinguished federal career. But first, one more introductory topic. Chet asked me to say a word or two about Deady's work in the circuit court, because he supposed we'd have a circuit judge or two here today, and I'm delighted that we do. That actually is a kind of complicated subject, but the short version is this. When I was teaching, I would always say, this is the version for the back row, the short and simple version. The 1789 Judiciary Act made circuit courts the primary trial courts of the new nation. It granted those courts diversity civil jurisdiction in cases where the amount of controversy exceeded $500, criminal jurisdiction over all major crimes except those committed on the high seas, and, of course, appellate jurisdiction over the district courts. Remember, Congress didn't create federal question jurisdiction until 1875, after the Civil War. District courts, by contrast, initially were to hear only admiralty courts, admiralty and revenue cases, plus a few minor civil and criminal disputes. Originally, a circuit court was to consist of two Supreme Court justices and the local district judge. That soon became, happily, one justice and the district judge. And importantly for Matthew Deady, in 1802, Congress provided that either of those two, either the justice or the judge, could preside over circuit court alone if the other were absent. So from his first day on the federal bench in 1859 and until 1891, Judge Deady presided often, indeed nearly always, alone on both the circuit court and the district court, typically on the same day. Many of his diary entries say, sat today in the CC and the DC. He was alone for so many of these sessions because, of course, Stephen Field, who was the Ninth Circuit Justice, didn't particularly like traveling from Washington, D.C. to the West Coast, even when he could do so later by railroad. The next piece of this story about circuit and district judge, I'm sorry this is so long, it's Chet's fault, occurred in 1869 when Congress created the Office of Circuit Judge, partly to ease Supreme Court travel burdens. Judge Deady badly wanted the Ninth Circuit position, and it looked for a long time like he would receive it. Justice Field, who admired Deady greatly, lobbied the Grant administration and several senators on Deedy's behalf. But at the 11th hour, Judge Ogden Hoffman, federal district judge in Northern California, who also was a candidate, wrote to various important people in D.C. that appointing Deady, whose tenure on the federal bench was shorter than Hoffman's at that time, that would be insulting to Hoffman, whereas appointing almost anybody else would not be. So the position went instead to Lorenzo Sawyer, a justice of the California Supreme Court. One final sentence, just to finish this. As no doubt you know, in 1891, Congress created the Circuit Courts of Appeals. President Harrison did appoint Matthew Deady to that court, but by that time, his age and poor health made it impossible for him to accept. He died less than 2 years later. All right, on to something more specific. I decided to tell you a little something today about Judge Deady's decisions relating to late 19th century enterprise. I did so because, to me, many of those decisions serve as a window onto an important and commendable feature of Deady's years on the federal bench. A theme, if you will. That theme, a central piece of his judicial philosophy, I believe, was that a court should strive, whenever possible, to achieve results consistent with the ethical sense of the community as well as with the law. In other words, Judge Deady revered the law, yes, but in case after case, when the law was less than clear, open to more than one reasonable interpretation, he tilted toward what he believed to be just results. Maybe I should say this is a different view of Deady from the snapshot that Tom gave you, where it's true, and I wrote about this, in land cases, he was very formalistic, and I actually think that's an aberration in his jurisprudence, certainly in his federal jurisprudence, and I think he was wrong there. But this is Deady. The most well-known and dramatic decisions in which Judge Deady achieved such just results, if you will, no doubt were those involving the rights and sensibilities of immigrant Chinese. I concluded my own long and perhaps tedious study of those decisions by concluding that for his serving as an outspoken champion of such a beleaguered minority population, Cleo, the muse of history, smiles on Matthew Deady. What were you going to say about that if you had given this talk? Okay. This same theme, a tilt toward justice, is also quite evident in Deady's many admiralty decisions. Repeatedly and sometimes in forceful terms, he imposed liability on shipowners for lost or stolen goods, ruled favorably on seamen's unpaid wage claims, and granted compensation against captains and their vessels for negligent or even deliberate personal injury or wrongful death at sea. Well, many of Judge Deady's enterprise-related decisions were quite similar in this respect. As perhaps you know, early Oregonians, and Tom touched on this, were very cautious toward large-scale enterprise. They opposed strongly the use of public money to subsidize private ventures. And by a constitutional requirement that taxation be uniform and equal, they sought to preclude many of the enterprise-related tax exemptions so common elsewhere at that time, and even today. Indeed, at the Constitutional Convention, Deady himself invoked Oregon's agricultural egalitarian way of life as a reason for denying limited liability to corporate shareholders, again, something Tom mentioned. He contrasted the condition of early Oregonians breathing the pure air with the canopy of heaven for a ventilator to the fate of workers in industrialized societies, those millions of poor human beings degraded into the condition of mere servants of machinery, overtasked and overworked, and seething in mystery and crime from the age of puberty to the grave. Deady had a way with words. So in 1857, at least, when frankly Deady was still more a politician than a judge, he proclaimed himself, quote, not in favor of encouraging a fungus growth of improvement in this country. But on the federal bench, of course, Judge Deady became more circumspect, less colorful, and indeed, I believe, entirely respectful toward the legal contentions of enterprise. However, by comparison with many of his judicial counterparts around the nation, it always seemed to me that Deady was unusually determined to protect both individuals and the public interest against those enterprise contentions. One can see this in four different legal contexts, as Tom said, 2 minutes each. You can read them, I won't read them. Even the back row can read them. So, on to the first. Regulating foreign corporations. In 1864, the Oregon legislature directed that every out-of-state corporation engaging in, quote, insurance, banking, or brokerage business within the state post a $50,000 bond and designate an agent for service of process. In the Comstock case, a bankruptcy trustee contended that a Canadian bank's noncompliance with that statute rendered its loan to the bankrupt illegal and void. Reviewing an exhaustive list of authorities, Deady concluded that yes, it did. The legislature's purpose, he wrote, to secure to the people of the state the right to sue a foreign corporation in the courts of the state, realistically could be accomplished only by declaring all business done by non-complying firms illegal and void. Just for balance, I thought I would tell you Rathbun. In that case, Deady exhibited his careful case-by-case look at the facts before him by declining to enforce the statute against a firm that lent only its own money. That firm was not a banking corporation. Yes, the text of the statute seemed to extend to all foreign corporations, but its title referred only to specific categories of them, so Deady held it did not apply to the lender before him. But finally, on this first of four mini topics in Semple, Deady again endorsed strongly the registration requirement for genuine foreign banking corporations, declaring again an Oregon borrower's note and mortgage to the bank illegal and void, one of his favorite phrases. The bank's attorney had had the temerity to criticize Deady's ruling in Comstock as harsh and prejudicial to the large foreign capital in the state. You know, what's good for General Motors is good for the USA. You know, you still hear that, don't you? Deady responded to that criticism, as he did often, with a lecture of his own. He could see, quote, no reason why this plain and wholesome statute should be refined or construed out of existence. A foreign corporation doing business in Oregon in deliberate defiance of the law had to take the consequences of such illegal conduct and hardly could complain. Either of the harshness of the law or of its enforcement, me. All right, so I take it those are public interest decisions for the most part. Policing public assistance to enterprise. In 1868, the Portland City Council, lured by the prospect of a rail link to San Francisco, voted to guarantee $350,000 of Oregon Central Railroad bonds, issue coupons for interest on those bonds, and impose a property tax to help finance them. In response, no surprise, a group of Portland property owners sued to have the ordinance declared unlawful, citing both a state constitutional prohibition against cities lending their credit to private corporations and a city charter prohibition against public debt exceeding $50,000. Deady held the subsidy ordinance, take a guess, illegal and void for violating the city charter's debt ceiling. He declined to follow an earlier California ruling that a similar ordinance created no debt because it also enacted a corresponding tax. That was, Deady wrote, a proposition in legal metaphysics beyond his comprehension. He praised Oregon's constitution and laws prohibiting public debt as laudable efforts to prevent mortgaging the present and future property and labor of the country for building railways and the like for the benefit of a few individuals. Deady, of course, as Thomas said, wrote a good bit of the constitution and many of those laws he was now referring to. Protecting victims of enterprise. Here I tell you about one of my very favorite Judge Deady opinions. The eminent Stanford legal historian Lawrence Friedman, in one of his early books, described how the railroad engine swept like a great roaring bull through the countryside, carrying out an economic and social revolution, but it exacted a tremendous toll. Thousands of men, women, and children injured or dead. Judge Deady decided several enterprise-related personal injury cases, most typically denying the defendant's new trial motion following a plaintiff's jury verdict. Easily the most interesting of these was Gilmore against the Northern Pacific. The plaintiff had been a railroad construction laborer in Montana, where occasionally it became necessary to thaw black powder for use as an explosive. The plaintiff's foreman repeatedly had ordered the thawing done over an open fire rather than in the reinforced kettle provided, and one day, of course, the powder exploded, killing the foreman and severely injuring the plaintiff laborer. The railroad's principal defense was that the negligent foreman had been the plaintiff's fellow servant. So under many 19th century English and American authorities, the plaintiff had, by implication at least, assumed all risk of the foreman's negligence. The theory behind that awful doctrine was that somehow this risk assumption was part of the so-called employment contract between the employer and the employee, which of course any employee could negotiate away at the time he or she was hired. You know, very realistic. Sorry, I editorialized too much, but anyway, and may I say happily, Judge Deady rejected the railroad's fellow servant defense and sustained the workers' $4,500 jury verdict. He distinguished between a true fellow servant working in the same gang under a common boss, and on the other hand, a foreman exerting practical direction and control over the work. The latter, the foreman, was in Deady's view a representative of the company. In his quite learned Gilmore opinion, Judge Deady described how the fellow servant rule had arisen in England in 1837 and then in America the following decade, how it had resulted in sizable amounts of hardship and injustice, how as a result the modern tendency was toward modification and limitation of the rule in order to place upon an employer a, quote, due and just share of responsibility for the lives and limbs of the persons in its employ. Good for him. Yeah. Fourth and finally, protecting navigability of the Willamette. Justice's opinion in Hatch against Willamette Iron Bridge Company is one of his most eloquent yet ultimately unsuccessful. Some of you know, I'm sure, Deady insisted his entire life this is how you spell the name of the river and the valley, that it was the original Indian spelling and pronunciation, and anything that he could control, like Deady reports, where that's how he spelled it. So, but it's a battle he lost. The 1878 Oregon legislature had authorized a drawbridge across the Willamette from Morrison Street on the west to N Street on the east. Shortly thereafter, the bridge company began building such a bridge, one designed to leave a 100-foot draw on each side of the central pier. Shortly after that, the owner of some warehouses just upriver from the bridge site, together with a steamboat operator, a federally licensed steamboat operator, sought a federal injunction against further construction. They contended that the bridge would constitute a serious and unlawful obstruction to the navigation of the river, violating both the federal steamboat licensing statute and, interestingly, the act admitting Oregon to the Union, which required that the state's navigable waters remain common highways and forever free. Judge Deady granted the injunction. The licensing statute didn't help the plaintiffs, both, quote, authority and prudential reason, other dichotomy he liked a lot, indicated that such a license merely authorized steamboat operation so far as the river may be navigable. The Statehood Act, however, was different in his view. The plain purpose of the language, common highways and forever free, taken from the 1787 Northwest Ordinance, was to preserve navigable waters for the free use of all citizens of the United States as common highways. Deady then described in forceful language the importance to the Willamette River to all Oregonians, the public interest, if you will. The commerce of Oregon, he wrote, both domestic and foreign, depended largely on its continued free navigation. It was the harbor of Portland, the river was, the emporium and financial center of the Northwest, where the valuable products of the country are gathered from far and near and stored for market and exportation, and the imports from sister states and foreign countries are received and distributed throughout the interior. By contrast, the proposed bridge would serve merely as a, quote, more convenient means of crossing the river for the small population that live in and around East Portland, a mere drop in the bucket, his words, compared to the many important public and private designs would injure. And finally, in Hatch, Deady reviewed a long series of federal statutes to sustain his decision, statutes authorizing bridges across the Mississippi, Missouri, and Ohio rivers, many of which required a clear opening of 160 feet on each side of the central pier. Moreover, in 1874, Congress had authorized the O&C Railway to bridge the Willamette at Portland, a bridge actually never built, and had required the draws to be no less than 150 feet. So Deady had no doubt, he wrote, the proposed bridge would constitute an unlawful obstruction to the free navigability of the Willamette. A month later, Circuit Judge Sawyer, remember his picture, arrived in Portland to rehear the case in the circuit court again, and he concurred fully with Deady's decision. 6 years later, however, justice was slow even then. That's not in here. I don't know how that got in here. 6 years later, the U.S. Supreme Court reversed Sawyer and Deady's decision unanimously. In that court's view, the bridge would not violate the act admitting Oregon to the Union because the prohibition there against obstructing navigation related not to physical obstructions, but only to political regulations that would hamper the free flow of commerce. The court distinguished its own well-known Wheeling Bridge decision, on which Sawyer and Deady had actually relied in part, as involving, Wheeling Bridge involved the competing interests of two states, West Virginia and then upriver Pennsylvania, whereas the Willamette River was wholly within the state of Oregon, so there wasn't any potential interstate difficulty. Thus was born the original Morrison Street Bridge. Looks different today, but that's how it looked then. So, okay, what to conclude from this brief snapshot? I believe Matthew Deady recognized repeatedly on the federal bench, as he had recognized at the Constitutional Convention, that the growth of industrial enterprise in our state, while laudable in many respects, inevitably threatened other equally important private and public values. He therefore provided to Oregonians a forum for airing a variety of grievances against enterprise, free from the economic and political favor enterprise enjoyed so often elsewhere during this early Gilded Age. Judge Deady cannot, in my view, fairly be called hostile to enterprise while on the bench, but he certainly did not intend to allow it to avoid legal or moral imperatives as he understood them. For that, as for his work in so many other areas, I repeat to you this afternoon, Cleo, the muse of history, smiles on Matthew Deady. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Jim. I'm sure glad that you made it up here, because I would have given an entirely different lecture than you did. I'm probably as hungry and thirsty as all of you are, so I'm not going to give a lecture. You notice I don't have notes, but I usually don't use notes when I lecture. I should warn you. But we've created an exhibit, the Pioneer Courthouse Historical Society, which we're unveiling today, and it will appear online, which may be a little bit easier for some of you to look at it. I encourage you to do so. Before I say a few more words, I want to a couple of guests we have here. First, in the back row, Linda Wissner, who is the designer of all the exhibits that you see here in the labels. Please stand up. I also want to introduce you to Brad Williams. Brad, would you stand up? Brad is the director of the Ninth Judicial Circuit Historical Society, and followed me after I had started that society nearly 30 years ago. And I did want to mention Western Legal History, a journal that I created it nearly 30 years ago now. It's kind of depressing to remember. And it's a journal of the history of law in the American West, and Brad continues to edit this. This particular issue that we have here, the most current issue, is about this building, Pioneer Courthouse. Dermot O'Scanlan has an article in here, and we're giving it free to members, new members of the Pioneer Courthouse Historical Society. Hint, hint. So, this exhibit about Matthew Paul Deady is more about Matthew Paul Deady than Judge Deady. He was not only a judge and a lawyer, he was a citizen in the true sense of the word, and a great leader of this city and state and the region. And fortunately for us, he was a avid reader and writer, as Chief Justice Balmer and Professor Mooney have said, and kept a diary from his younger days almost to the time when he passed away in 1893. And through his pen, we can read about so much of the development of Portland from the 1860s to the 1890s. People, institutions, the creation of the University of Oregon, the growth, development of the Portland Public Library, colleges, law schools, the experience that the arts and entertainment field had in Oregon. He was a great aficionado of opera, and seemingly every night he would attend the opera or some play. I don't know how he did work, but he was always going out to dinners, which he would write about. He'd write about the menus. So this exhibit tries to pull together some of that, but the exhibit's very much built and based on the diaries, the collected diaries and published diaries of of Matthew Paul Deady. And they, alas, are no longer available in published form because they've sold out. Just about 40 years ago, next year actually, in this very room, when I was brand new manager of publications of the Historical Society, we unveiled the books here in this very room, and we thought that the publisher or the printer had fallen asleep at the press because we had far too many books, hardbound, paperbound, boxed books. But they're all gone, alas, and there are only a few left. You can occasionally pick them up, but they are wonderful pieces of Oregon history and Oregon legal and judicial history. So if you get your hands on a copy, hold on to it, as I know Chief Justice Balmer and Professor Mooney would say. So we invite you to go back downstairs to enjoy a reception, each other's company, look at the exhibit that's in the atrium there, right down the building, and Historical Society, I invite all of you to join us in our efforts. Thank you.
Thank you.
so I'll grab my books here.